Nick Robinson.
Thank you very much, First Minister. Nick Robinson, BBC News. Two, if I may. One specifically on RBS that you raised. Are you suggesting that the decision of RBS has no consequence, or do you accept that by moving their base to London, tax revenues would move to London? In other words, Scottish taxpayers would have to make up the money they would lose from RBS moving to London. And on a more general point, John Lewis's boss says prices could go up. Standard Life's boss says money will move out of Scotland. BP's boss says oil will run out. Why should a Scottish voter believe you, a politician, against men who are responsible for billions of pounds of profits?
Well, can I start? No, let us answer, and I'll be able to perhaps do a reverse question to the BBC's role in these matters, which I'm sure Nick will be perfectly happy to explain. Firstly, can I just correct... can I correct you on a factual point, Nick? The corporation tax does not depend on registered office, but on economic activity. For example, our estimates on corporation tax for Scotland at the present moment don't include the profits of NatWest or any of the Royal Bank's operations anywhere else in the UK, just because the brass plaque is in Scotland. That's not how corporation tax works. Now, I've seen a number of quotes from various people who should know a great deal better, but that's how corporation tax is allocated. It's not allocated where your registered office is, it's allocated on economic activity. That's the rules of corporation tax. In terms more generally of this issue, let's go into the generality. I think the people of Scotland have moved beyond these warnings and scaremongerings, particularly when there is a clear evidence that while the Prime Minister was busy telling us what a wonderful nation we were, his business advisor was busy desperately trying to get any business he possibly could to say something negative about independence. I thought it was quite interesting yesterday, and I know this might be news to some of the metropolitan media, that the warnings which were released yesterday were actually a recycling of things from months ago. Bob Dudley, for example, if I remember correctly, made exactly the same statement in February, and Standard Life made exactly the same statement 3 months ago. I know that it was news to some people, but certainly wasn't news to the people of Scotland. But let me turn very specifically to the question of the Royal Bank of Scotland. I've read you the statement to staff released this morning from the chief executive of the Royal Bank. I've read the whole thing, so in the relevant paragraph, just let me briefly remind you. It is my view as Chief Executive that any decision to move a registered headquarters should have no impact on everyday banking services. This is a technical procedure regarding the location of our registered head office. Based on current strategy, it is not intention to move operations or jobs. It's not a matter of operations or jobs, it is a technical matter in the opinion of the Chief Executive of the Royal Bank of Scotland. I've also heard many times on the BBC the argument that Lloyds Banking Group are about to move their headquarters to London. I would have thought, given the headquarters of the BBC in London, that the BBC might have known that Lloyds Banking Group has their headquarters in London, has had for many, many years, and has no jobs in its registered, attached to its registered office, which is, of course, a plaque in the mound, which is there not incidentally to do with the Bank of Scotland, it's there because of Lloyd's takeover of the TSB many years ago. So I then come to what I think is now the most interesting matter, which is who in the Treasury, because I have here a screen grab from the BBC last night, I don't know if this was you, Nick, or one of your colleagues, a Treasury source told the BBC that it had discussed the plans with the Royal Bank of Scotland. The Treasury officials or ministers are not allowed to brief market-sensitive information. Market-sensitive information, and it's a basic rule, cannot be released prior to the market announcement at 7 o'clock this morning. The Royal Bank of Scotland share price changed overnight. This is a matter of extraordinary gravity. I've always respected, and I would continue to respect, the journalistic right to maintain and protect sources. But I know that the BBC will want to cooperate with the inevitable investigation by the Cabinet Secretary into the briefing of this information. Given the briefing of information, even if we weren't in a referendum campaign, even if there weren't purdah rules which are meant to apply to government, the briefing of market-sensitive information is as serious a matter as you possibly can get. And therefore, I know the BBC, in its impartial role as a public sector broadcaster, will give full cooperation to that investigation. Now, can I go back to our friends in the international media, please? This is an international... Sorry, Nick, I'm going back to our friends in international media. Please, there. I don't think... I mean, I'll tell you what... Well, I've just read you the statement. Well, right. And I answered that question. Nick, this has been a lively campaign with heckling at many meetings across Scotland. This is the first opportunity the BBC have had to heckle at a meeting. Congratulations, Nick. I answered you. The corporation tax is based on... Yeah, remember the first start of the question? The corporation tax is based on economic activity, not on your registered office. In, for example... Yes, Nick, please. In, for example, the statement I've given you, and, for example, in the Scottish Government calculations of corporation tax, we do not count the activities of Royal Bank of Scotland in London or NatWest or elsewhere. It's based, Nick, on economic activity. That is the rules of corporation tax. And given that the chief executive of the Royal Bank of Scotland has said this does not involve, even if it happens, the movement of operations or jobs, and it is, after all, a contingency, but wouldn't involve the movement of operations and jobs, then clearly it would have no impact on personal tax revenues either. And I know that we'll want to report the very sensible statements from Angus Grossart and also from Martin Gilbert of Aberdeen Asset Management this morning. Not saying how they will vote, because that's a private matter for them, but pointing out in their estimation as two giants of the Scottish financial sector that the Scottish financial sector will prosper under independence, as indeed they believe it would prosper under any circumstances. So I think that's a reasonably comprehensive answer, Nick. And then, of course, I know that given I've given you a comprehensive answer, we'll have the full cooperation of the BBC in the inevitable inquiry which will now take place. Can I go to our friends... in the international media.
Thank you very much.
He's a week away from a place in history, but will it be as Scotland's nearly man or as the father of a newly independent nation?
Scotland is on the cusp of making history. The eyes of the world are upon Scotland. And what the world is seeing is an articulate, peaceful, energised debate. Scotland will vote yes next Thursday.
All that confidence despite a steady drumbeat of warnings of the economic risks of independence. Four banks have now said they're moving their legal base from Scotland to England. Today, a series of high street retailers warned of a possible impact on prices in their stores of operating across a new border. Asda's boss said they'd have to reflect the costs of operating in two different countries. John Lewis's chairman spoke of the likelihood of higher prices, but Tesco have denied no campaign claims that they would charge more. This week, reporters have flown to Edinburgh from all over the world. But Alex Salmond knows that for victory, he needs to reassure voters at home.
Why should a Scottish voter believe you, a politician, against men who are responsible for billions of pounds of profits?
He didn't answer, but he did attack the reporting of those in what he called the metropolitan media. To make his point, he read out a letter from the chief executive of the Royal Bank of Scotland about its decision to move its registered HQ to London.
And let me read the key paragraph. Based on our current strategy and business plan, it is not our intention to move operations or jobs.
Mr. Salmond said there'd be no loss of tax revenues either. It was simply a matter of shifting brass plates. Waving the BBC's story, he said there should be an official inquiry into the Treasury for what he said was the leaking of market-sensitive information, a tack he clearly thinks is the best form of defence.
They have now been caught red-handed as being part of a campaign of scaremongering. And it provides a spectacular example of sort of campaign tactics of intimidation and bullying. And therefore, I know the BBC, in its impartial role as a public sector broadcaster, will give full cooperation to that investigation.
The closer this referendum looks, the more heated it risks becoming. Today, on the streets of Glasgow, Ed Miliband turned his fire on Alex Salmond.
So, don't listen to the lies and scaremongering of the SNP. The only person who can privatise the NHS in Scotland is Alex Salmond, and that is the truth.
That's a lie!
Earlier, over 100 Labour MPs travelled up together on the train from London to join their Scottish colleagues.
There's a sign of real belief that we're better together. How are you? You're right.
Their battle to convince voters here that independence is a risk not worth taking.
Every Scottish bank has now said that if there's a yes vote, they're going to move business south of the border. It's not about brass plates, it's about brass tacks. This will cost jobs, it will cost us the funds we need to pay for the health service and for schools. And Asda have just announced that prices will go up if there's independence, and all Alex Salmond can do is shrug his shoulders and say it doesn't matter. Well, it does matter.
Alex Salmond knows that the eyes of the world are upon him. He says that this is the beginning of something and not the end. As for all those questions, all those doubts, he dismisses those as scaremongering. Nick Robinson, BBC News, Edinburgh.
Well, Alex Salmond has...